evening. This is Pastor Barbara, aka Preacher with Parrots. Today is January 15th, 2017. It's Sunday evening. So we have a live Bible study, and we are, since it's Sunday, we are in the New Testament. Basically, we would be going one book in the New Testament, followed by the next book, followed by the next book. However, because the Gospels all write about the same thing, I find it better anytime I'm talking about the Gospels to consider them as one book. So we may get a repetition because I may read something from Matthew and the same thing might be in Luke, in which case we read it again. But that's the way we're going through the Gospels. When we finish the Gospels and get in the book of Acts, then we'll just be one book at a time. We're in the book of Matthew. We ended last Sunday night. In verse 10. I'm going to go back over and mention. Hi, Shelley. I think this is the first time you've been here, right? I would have remembered Shelley. Anyway, you're welcome here. As soon as I finish teaching, we will open it to chatters and guests and everybody. And while you're welcome to stay, and we hope you do, we have it closed to ops only. Hi, Grace. When I'm teaching, because I'm old, I can get distracted easily and so forth. So hang on in here if you'd like. I'm glad you're here. We're going to go back to the first few verses. If we weren't in Matthew, I would have probably been reading Father or Lord, teach us to pray. Matthew begins this way. Be not ye therefore like them. He was talking about people that pray using vain repetitions. I think in English, we would probably use the term saying your prayers. In Spanish, they have a word that Catholics use that Protestants don't. Throughout all of Spanish-speaking America, or even Spanish-speaking Europe, and it's rezar. And it's very similar to the word recite, which I think vain, repetitious praying is. It is reciting. It is simply saying something, you've learned it, and some people can do that and do other things at the same time. I mean, I do well if I tie my shoes and chew gum at the same time, but some people can do a lot of things at the same time. But you can recite. You can recite things that you've learned, and you don't have to keep your mind on it. It just sort of, anyway. Jesus has been talking to Sadducees and others who like to just recite prayers. They would do it out in the public. They would do it in front of the temple. They would do it wherever people watched them, because what they wanted was to be seen. And Jesus said, okay, we've all seen you. Now you got what you want. Here it says, be not like them. Your Father knows what you need of before you ask. If God already knows what you need, then what's the point of you praying? See, unfortunately, so many people don't know this. You know, I wish I would have thought about it before I sat down here. I would have pulled it up where I could read it to you. Maybe I have it on my cell phone. I'll check. A prayer request that came into prayer and praise. Let me see what prayer is. to many people. You won't believe one of the prayer requests that came in. But let me check. It may take me a moment here. Here's one prayer that somebody wrote down. This is not a prayer request. Dear Father, holy and righteous judge, help me not to condemn myself by passing judgment on someone else when I may be doing the same or similar things. How could I escape your judgment and do this? Help me not to presume the riches of the kindness and forbearance of others. Let me go to the next paragraph. Change my behavior and my attitudes so that none of your wrath will be stored against me in the day of your righteous judgment. This is a person who is kind of using the prayer to teach people what prayer is. So many people that write prayer and praise, and if you have a prayer request, you can write prayerandpraise@charter.net. And I get it on some of my computers, and I get it on my cell phone. I was looking for, I'll tell you in a moment just basically what that prayer request was. But this is how we should pray. We pray, should pray, that we become better Christians, that we become more like Christ. All of our praying should be, Lord, less of me and more of you. The Apostle Paul said, you must increase, speaking of God. God must get bigger. And I must decrease. I must be less important. I must be nothing so that he can be everything. To people, praying is, Lord, I need this, 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 this. There was a prayer request. I work with several other groups, so that when I send prayer requests out, some of them are prayer requests that have been sent to me, but some of them are prayer requests that have been sent to other organizations. Because of that, the last time we checked, we had just a little over 400,000 prayer partners. We had the leader of one organization, it was smaller than the others, but the leader of one passed away, and so I'm sure our number has come down. But even if you were to cut it in half, we have 225,000 people who get our prayer requests. So some of us, because there are several of us that work together, I decide which prayer requests of other people I want to publish in my report. And if any of you want to get my mailings, then you can also write to prayerandpraise@charter.net. This guy wrote he wanted a bilingual wife. She could be Japanese or some other Asian ethnicity. He didn't have children, so he wanted her to be young enough to have many. And he went on and on and on with a bunch of stupidity. Is it wrong to ask God to give you a spouse? Absolutely not. I mean, if you're not married. But his prayer request was, I want this and this and this and this and this and this. You know, and like, I want it day after tomorrow, God. Prayer is two-way. It's not you sit down before God and tell him everything you want. Most of the time, we don't even know what's good for us. Half the time we eat food that's not good for us. We do a lot of things that aren't good for us. There are other people that feel, hi Granny. There are other people that feel that the more people that pray for their request, the more they are to get it answered. And for a while, there was somebody from one of the European countries that would write down the name of every distant relative, everybody that she knew, for no reason. There is in the state, I believe it's either Oregon or state of Washington, somebody that had a prayer organization that got into trouble because they were using money that people sent in the wrong way. Now, nobody sends money into my organization, so there's no way I'm going to misspend any money you send me. Other than buying computers and ISP and things like that, I have no needs that have to be met. No expenses that have to be paid, and I don't have the money to pay them. Why were people sending money? And by the way, this person had fewer people praying than what our organizations do. Why did people send him money? Because he guaranteed thousands of people would pray. And that was enough money, reason for some people to send him money so that thousands of people could pray. Prayer is two-way. It's talking with God. It's not telling God what you want or what you think you need. That's part of it. At the end of my teaching, we open chat to everybody, and everybody can share. Everybody can talk. It's not just one person talking. That's not prayer. Every once in a while, I'll send out some saying. One of the sayings that I sent out that really affected a friend of mine, bless her a lot, was a saying that sometimes God wants to change us. Instead of giving us the stuff that we want, he wants a different person in us. The very fact that all somebody can think about is what they want. Are we being featured? I don't have my, I guess we are. I'm looking because of the number of people that were here, and I don't, so we have people, by virtue of the fact that we're being featured, we have people that aren't tuned into us. You're welcome to come back anytime if you like. And like I said, if you have a prayer request, it's prayerandpraise@charter.net. And if you want any of our messages, you Google Preacher with Parrots and it will send you to my Twitter, my YouTube, my, it doesn't send you to my Facebook, but eventually you learn how to get in touch with us. And if we can help you or be a blessing to you, then we want to do that too. We should want the Lord to change us. Unless we think we're perfect the way we are, we should want the Lord to help us cooperate in becoming more like him. and less of us and more of him. I happen to have two, I don't know why. One is a jar with birds on it. The other one is a Christmas greeting jar, about the same size. But this is a, since I have them up here, I'll use this example. Do I have a friend request? Let me look into the friend request later. I'll do that as soon as I can. Mine isn't working all the time, and I have to do it a little bit differently. Okay. Look. This is now empty. This is how we start out. There's nothing here. So if this represents what God wants in my life, this is empty. I can now fill it. But if it's full, I can't. This one now is almost full. It's to right here. If what's in it represents me and my wishes, there's only this much left for God and his. If it's full of one thing, you can't put anything else in it. But if you empty it of yourself, what you want, what pleases you, what makes you happy, it's gone. It's empty. You can now be adding what God wants to give you, what he wants to make of you. What he wants to do with your life. How he can make you a blessing to somebody else. And your goal should be every day when you pray, empty yourself. Lord, forget where I wanted to go on a vacation. Where do you want me to go? Where can I be a blessing to you? What should I do with the day off I have next Thursday, where I can be a blessing to somebody? There's nothing wrong with saying, Lord, I really would like to go to a ball game. My family is crazy for baseball. Have any of you ever been to a donkey baseball game? I think we've talked about that in the past. They are a riot. I don't know if they still have them. But you can, one or two places on the internet, you can find them. But if nobody explains to you what it is, it's hard to figure out what they're doing. They are a riot. They are a lot of fun. And there's nothing wrong with it. And there's nothing wrong with enjoying yourself. And there's nothing wrong without having a day off. And there's nothing wrong with having a lot of fun. But you should give every day to the Lord and let him lead you. Because I guarantee, wherever he leads you and uses you, you will be so much happier than if you just picked a place yourself. It's a lesson that we learn little by little. You don't become a praying grandma overnight. One day I heard a preacher talking. He was in his 40s. I was at a minister's meeting. He had all kinds of ideas, all kinds of stuff. And I said, you know what? I know more than you. Now, y'all know that I don't believe in acting like that. I know more than you all. This guy needed to be put down a step or two. God taught the Apostle Paul that pride goeth before a fall. And God actually caused him to suffer rather than allow him to gloat over how smart and how valuable in God's service he was. God put a thorn in his flesh to remind him that he wasn't all that. Because we got to get ourselves out of the quotient if we're going to put God in. That's prayer. Prayer is not stating what you want. It started out, thy kingdom come. Lord, the day is coming. First the resurrection of the dead and then the living, or the rapture, whatever you want to call it. And then a period of a little more than 7 years. And then Jesus comes with those that he has lifted in the rapture, comes with them when his feet touch the Mount of Olives. His kingdom has now come. Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. First, he starts with praise. We did that last week. Your kingdom come. Lord, I'm waiting the day when you rule everybody right now. Jesus rules those of us that want him to rule us. We call him Lord. That's what Lord means. Lord is the one you choose to put in charge. There's that song. Mary called him Jesus, born of a virgin. The angels called him Jesus, but I call him Lord. Elizabeth said to Mary, when I heard your voice, my baby, John the Baptist, inside of me moved. I'm blessed that the mother of my Lord has come to see him. Now, Jesus wasn't even born yet. He was a fetus, 2 or 3 week old fetus in utero. But Elizabeth knew who he was, and she made him Lord. Only you can make him Lord. He doesn't come in and say, move everybody, move over, I'm here to run things. Jesus doesn't do that. You take yourself out of the way so there's room for him. And then you invite him in. And you may be Lord or Lady of the manor. But when you invite him in, you make him Lord. You should do that in prayer. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In heaven, God the Father rules. and God the Father and God the Son are together. His will is done in heaven. In my heart, I get to choose who rules me. I choose to let Jesus rule. And when I make that choice, I am making him Lord. Lord is, the word means the one you put in charge. He doesn't come in and put himself in charge. He is Lord if you put him in charge. And Elizabeth, his aunt, mother of John the Baptist, chose to put him in charge before he was even born. Now, I know that the Hail Mary says, I'm blessed that the mother of God, but God does not have a mother. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, which is Jesus. And the Word was with God, the Father. And the Word was God, they're both God. In the beginning. And by the spoken word, they created things. And nothing that was created without their spoken word. If it exists, it exists because they spoke it into existence. That is who Jesus is, and that is who Lord is. And the Bible says, the mother of my Lord. I don't know why in the prayer or recitation that is used, it's been changed to mother of God. God has no mother. Because God has always existed. If God had to have a mother, then she would be God. She would have existed first. The Creator exist before what the Creator creates. God existed before he created the world, not the other way around. And God the Son have always existed. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Now we come to a realistic need. There are things we want and there are things we need. There's nothing wrong with asking God, Lord. I remember I was born in the Depression. I was born under Calvin Coolidge. And then came Franklin Delano Roosevelt, who was elected to 4 terms but died in the 4th. I was a child. Most of the time of my memory, because I don't remember the first year or two, was Franklin Delano Roosevelt. When I was born, we didn't have a lot of money. My dad made $21 a week. Thank God he had a job. And thank God he used his money for his family. So some people get paid on Friday night. By Saturday, it's all been left at the neighborhood bar. There's nothing wrong with praying for what you need. Reminding God of that. Give us this day our daily bread. Give me, Lord, food. I need food to survive. So give me enough food for today. I'm not asking for a week. I'm not asking for a month's worth of food. I'm asking for food for today. On Wednesday night, we're in the Old Testament, and we are now dealing with Joseph in Egypt. And Wednesday night, we'll talk about Joseph's father, his younger full brother Benjamin, and his other half-brothers. We'll go to Egypt to see him, to buy food. He has stored away food for 7 years. Because they had 7 years of plenty. And God helped him interpret a dream that meant that those 7 years of plenty would be followed by 7 years of famine, so take care of what you need. In a week or two, we will be ending the study of Genesis, and we'll go into the book of Exodus. When Moses brings them, they exit from Egypt after 400 years there. Shortly after that, when there's an opportunity to go into the promised land and they don't behave properly, they wind up walking in the wilderness, the desert, for 40 years. For 40 years, they had manna, a biscuit, a fat tortilla. They picked it up enough each day off the ground for one day. On Friday, because Saturday was the Sabbath. By that time, right now where we're studying, they are not under the law of Moses. But when we get in the book of Exodus, after Moses comes down from Mount Sinai and gets the law, they are then under a law. And that law has them resting on the Sabbath. So on Friday, they get enough food for 2 days. But on Friday, they eat half of it. And on Saturday, they eat half. The food is on the ground. They have to pick it up. The amount they pick up is up to them. God tells them, and Moses tells them how much to pick up. But if they pick up more, it's going to rot. Because God is giving them their daily need. If they pick up double on Friday, it does not rot. Because God is allowing them to keep the Sabbath holy as he has told them to. If you trust God, this is heavy. This is deep. If you trust God, you don't need food for tomorrow. You need something to put in your tummy right now. And then you need to know that tomorrow, God will take care of tomorrow's needs. If you want that food today, it's because you don't trust God to do tomorrow what he's done for today. We're very guilty of this. We say we trust God. We believe in him. You know, all the lessons that I'm giving you. Yeah, I believe all of that. I have no reason not to believe it. I remember I was in Bible college. And in those days, kids used to work their way through college. Now the parents pay for them, and the government gives them a loan or somehow. But we used to work. I remember I got fired from a job. I wasn't very good at it. I was only 16 when I went to college. When I was 17, I got hired first by a bank and then by a publishing company doing something that I'm not good at. I'm good with people. I enjoyed nursing. I enjoyed my years as a courtroom interpreter. Enjoyed my years as a public school teacher. I enjoyed my years teaching young men and women how to become preachers. But when it comes to pushing buttons and putting this piece of paper over there and that piece of paper over there, I'm not good at that. And I got fired. They were good enough. Rather than keep me on another 2 weeks and let me make 2 weeks of mistakes because I wasn't good at it. In those days, they would fire you, but they would give you 2 weeks' pay. And I didn't go out right away and look for another job. And the college called me in and said, you better be looking for a job. And I said, what's the matter? You don't have faith? It's not tomorrow yet. And I was preaching them this. Of course, they were doing it for my good. And I didn't have the good sense to realize that. We really only need what we need today. God will take care of tomorrow. My close friends know, and you will know in a month or two, some things I've been going through for a while. Really distressful. Really painful. But I've been serving Jesus since I was 11 years old. And I know some things. Like I told this preacher I mentioned earlier. I said, you and I both know what it's like to be a young preacher. I started out, I was 22. Before that, I was somebody else's assistant and did some music. I was very young. And I said, you're very young. I said, but now I know what it is to be an old preacher. You're making plans on all these old preachers that are working for you because, see, there's the head pastor, but he had 200 deacons. I don't know how many co-pastors. I said, there's things you haven't learned yet because you haven't lived yet. Give us this day our daily bread. Yeah, I'm sort of making plans for the next year or two. But really, I only have to trust the Lord for today. But I have an advantage in being old. That means I've lived a long time. That means there's many days I've gone to bed on a Friday not knowing where I was going to get Saturday's payment from, but it always came in. I remember the first year that I traveled as an evangelist. In those days, we didn't have a bank account. There were no credit cards. The first credit cards that came out were automobile gasoline credit cards, but we didn't have any of those. If you didn't have money, you didn't put gas in your car. If you didn't put gas in your car, you didn't go anywhere. And we were evangelists. But I had this deep, abiding faith. And I still have it today. I haven't changed. From 20 to 85, I have not changed. It's still working. I said, if God has called me to the ministry, then he will have to take care of my bills being paid. And I wasn't smart-mouthing God. I worked among the poorest of the poor in the 50s with migrants. And people pay their tithes to the church. And then their offerings, which are what is left, is what the evangelist gets. And we didn't have any promise, any guarantee of any money coming in. And I knew how long it took a letter to get from, let's say, Texas to Michigan, where maybe I was paying for a car I bought there or something. And I sort of knew when I needed how much money. But I made up my mind I would never tell anybody. If, for example, I came to you, and I'm hinting, some of you have been with me over 10 years, and you know me, and we love each other, we're friends. If I hinted that maybe I didn't have money to fix a computer that wasn't working or something, you might put 10 bucks in the mail or something and send it to me. And then I'd have a problem. I wouldn't know if God supplied that 10 bucks or if you felt sorry for me and gave me 10 bucks. And if you're in the ministry, even if you're not, you need to know God is taking care of your needs, not people. God uses people. But it's coming from God. And I made up my mind I would never tell anybody I needed money. Now, I know people that, you know, you do too. They'll say in the church, pray for me, I have a financial need. Well, are you telling God you got a need because he already knows it? Or are you telling the people and you're hoping that maybe they're going to kick in a little? I made up my mind I would never hint. I would never tell anybody what situation we were in, because if I was truly called, God would take care of me. If he wasn't taking care of me, then maybe I'm not really called. Maybe I don't need to be doing what I'm doing. Maybe God has somebody else. Give us this day. This day, our daily bread, not our weekly bread, not our monthly bread, not our yearly bread, our daily bread, not our steak, not our lobster, our daily bread. It was 11 o'clock one evening. We'd been in the ministry a couple months. I'm not good at taking money. To me, it's awkward. People try to help you with that awkwardness. Well, I know there are times like I'll have a flat tire and somebody, years ago, I mean, my tires don't go flat now, but years ago, I'd get a flat tire and somebody would change it. And so I would take a $5 bill and say, you know, have a cup of coffee on me or something. You want to give them something. You don't want to embarrass them. I'm never terribly, terribly comfortable with, I enjoy giving money, but I never know how to take it. And we were sitting in the car, and the trailer was hooked up to the car. It was 11 o'clock on a Friday. We had to put by Saturday in the mail a payment for the car, either the car or the trailer. I don't know which, but those were the two things we were always making payments on. And somebody gave me a couple of bills and said, God bless you, this is for your ministry or something. And because I'm so awkward taking it, I just said, thank you and God bless you. And I just put it in the pocket, like, thank you. You know, I'm not good at this. And they said, oh, don't think it's just $2, because I treated it kind of casually, you know. It's not $2. I said, I know, it's $2.20s. And they said, how do you know that? Because tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock, I have to send off a $40 payment. You just gave me two bills. It's not likely anybody's going to show up with any more money as late as it is now. Besides, we don't tell anybody what we need. So I just presume two bills. If I need $40, it's going to be $2.20s. That's the life that I have lived. Of course, when you live this many years, it takes 20. Now it takes 30 years to buy a house. And by that time, you have a little equity built up. And by the time you're my age, you may be comfortable. Not wealthy, but comfortable. Not worried. You still have to pay taxes. You still have to pay insurance. But you don't have those high payments. And you're a little bit more comfortable. Give us this day our daily bread. Here comes a big one. Wow. This is one that I have to live. If I didn't live this one, I'd die. I literally would die. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now, it depends what version you're reading. This one is King James. Some of them were, forgive us our trespasses. You know, when you go on somebody else's property that's not yours and they don't want you there, you have trespassed. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. There's another version. Forgive us our offenses as we forgive those who offend us. People that have done bad stuff to us, to the degree that I forgive them for what they did to me. This is heavy, guys. The degree that I forgive people who've done me bad, who've hurt me. Some of them on purpose. Some because they don't know better. But the degree that I forgive somebody that hurt me, to that degree, God's going to forgive me. That means if I've offended God, and God has two rules for what sin, what offends him. Two. Something he says don't do and you do it. You have offended God. You have sinned. That's one category of sin. God doesn't want you to do something, you do it anyway. The other is, to him that knoweth to do the right and doeth it not, to him it is sin. If there's something you know you should do, something that needs the $5, you know, every woman's got money hidden somewhere. There's a certain spot in your purse. Nowadays, with many people, if they can afford it, it's a $100 bill. Because now women drive alone many, many miles. You can totally damage a tire so that a spare is out of the question. And you've got to buy another tire. It's not unusual for women who can to have $100 hidden somewhere. But if not that amount of money, at least some amount of money to get you over a hard spot. Because you never know what's going to happen before you get back home. And sometimes we travel, you know, 50, 60, 100 miles. To the degree that I forgive you, that means if I easily forgive you and say, that's okay, don't worry about it. To that degree, God will forgive me my times that I offend him. I offend God when I ask him for more than a day's worth of bread. It means I don't trust him for tomorrow. I offend God when I want something and I know it's not in my best interest and God doesn't want me to have it, but I want it anyway. You get over that by learning to grow in grace, just like you learn to grow up. When you're 2 years old, I want this, I want the other. If you don't get it, you're in a store pitching a fit. But as we grow up, that's why I like the term new birth or born again, as opposed to just saying salvation or forgiven sins, because it helps us realize that we start out inexperienced and we need somebody to help us grow up, say, no, we don't do this. No, this is what we do. We don't do the other. As we mature, now there are people that are 70 years old, and the amount of faith they have in God is about the same as I had when I was 7, because they haven't grown. If you don't grow 1 inch, you'll never grow a foot. I'll repeat that. You've got to grow an inch before you can grow a foot. Some young people, new Christians, they love God and they're very, very serious about their commitment to them. And they grow fast. I remember a friend of ours in the ministry. We preached for him in Michigan, and then he went to Denver, and we preached for him there, and then he came out. He was in California, and we were out here in California, and we preached revival for him then. His daughter, when she was 12 years old, she was the best little altar worker I ever saw. People that needed to be in the altar, she went and talked to them, took them down the altar. She'd pray for them. She'd counsel them. She'd talk to them. I never saw anybody as good as she. She was just a natural. She grew and grew and grew and grew and grew. I know people that are 60, 70, 80 that are not there yet, and they're not going to get there. They just don't grow. If I don't forgive you, God's not going to forgive me. If I forgive you easily and you really hurt me, as somebody coming on here and writing something stupid. That doesn't bother me. They need to learn not to do it, but it doesn't bother me. That I can offend easily, I can forgive easily. As we grow and mature, one of the things we have to learn is how easy can we forgive. And you gotta learn to forgive if you're gonna be forgiven. And unless you're born perfect and never make a mistake, you're going to need forgiveness. And because you're going to need forgiveness, you better learn how to give forgiveness. And sometimes it's hard. Now, some people say, Pastor, you don't know what that dirty so-and-so's done to me. I will never forgive that dirty so-and-so. Who is getting hurt? Who is getting hurt? You don't forgive somebody that did something nasty to you. Who is hurt? That guy may be so stupid, he's not even aware of the fact that he hurt you. So he's not going to ask you forgiveness. He may be a mean, nasty person. I stopped in a pharmacy, they sell everything, magazines, clothes, dishes in pharmacies now. We used to call them drug stores. And I saw a magazine, and it was talking about from prison, Manson was committing murder. In other words, he was having other people murder for him. If you say, I'm not going to forgive that dirty so-and-so, you are not hurting him. He could care less. But you're hurting yourself. Withholding forgiveness from him is not hurting him. He could care less. You are hurting you. And God says, to the degree, if you forgive easily, I'll forgive you easily. If we have to argue and get concerned and all of that to forgive, well then, don't expect me to forgive you just like that. If you do not forgive, you are hurting you. You're not hurting them. Let's get some things understood. I told you early on in this program that over a year or so period of time, a couple of people made it their business to hurt me. Hey, there are people like that. There's all kinds of people in this world. Over the Thanksgiving holiday, they really hurt me. It so happened I wasn't feeling very well. I've been serving the Lord a long time. I may know something you don't know, because I've simply been around longer and have more experience. So don't feel bad if you say, Pastor, I can't do that. Just make it something you want God to help you with, as opposed to something you absolutely refuse to do. I know, because I'm old and I'm experienced and I know the Word of God, and I know that when you forgive, a burden lifts off of you that brings to you healing. I wasn't feeling well. For a moment in my mind, I was thinking about these people and what they did to me and how wrong they were. And there was a spot of something on the floor. I'm telling you this to show you how vivid my memory of it is. I was feeling some pain. We are a complicated being. We have a body, we have a mind, and we have a spirit. If I fail to forgive, my spirit is affected, and that interferes with my fellowship with God. I thought you said somebody offended you. Yeah, somebody hurt me. But my failure to forgive affects my fellowship with God. Those people had nothing to do with my fellowship with God. But if I fail to forgive them, well, do they deserve being forgiven? That has nothing to do with it. My healing is not based on what they do. My healing is based on my fellowship with God. The moment, I'm going to do something here. Okay, you can see that in the other room, there's a chair and there's a table. That's the dining room. I'm going to move it back now. I was there. I saw a spot on the floor. I got an old washcloth and I got it wet. I put this hand on the table. I took this hand with my wet washcloth. And I'm wiping that spot on the floor. But in my mind, I'm thinking about them. And I said, I forgive them. Did they deserve to be? I don't think so. I don't think they deserve forgiveness. They didn't ask for it. I think they're trying to not get into trouble. But really feel sorry and want to be forgiven? I don't think so. But we're not talking about them. We're talking about me. And while my hand is on the table and I'm bending, the hand is there to keep me from falling on my face while I'm bent over, right? You understand that. And I'm mopping up that little spot. And God said, forgive them. And I said, okay, God, I forgive them. Now, my complicated body, which is a body, a mind, and a spirit that has fellowship with God, because my mind and my mouth said and meant it, I forgive. Guess what? All of a sudden, the pain was gone. Now, this is pretty vivid. Like I said, been around a long time. Long enough to read the Bible many times through. Long enough to understand what it says. Long enough to know I'm not going to let some unimportant person in my life come between me and God, which is exactly what's going to happen if I don't forgive them. Now, here's what everybody wants to know about. I forgive them. Are they going to come back in my life and get another chance to do the same thing to me? No. Many, many people will say to you, then you really haven't forgiven them. Yes, I have. When you are a mature Christian being, you know the difference. You know in your heart if you have released that or if you're still holding on to it. Whether I forgive them or don't, whether they care or don't, whether they're glad they hurt me or not, we're talking about my fellowship with God, which has something to do, my mind has something to do with my body. And my mind and my body have something to do with my spirit. Forget them. We're talking about me. If I forgive them, then God and I are on friendly terms. If I choose to forgive them, does that mean they didn't do anything wrong? No, they're still wrong. They were wrong if I forgive them. They were wrong if I don't forgive them. They were wrong. But my forgiving them gives me freedom to serve God. Freedom to receive blessings from Him. And if I don't forgive them, then I'm going to meet God and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. That doesn't mean it's okay what they did. And different things require different reactions. Somebody was visiting our program some time ago, and they had questions about forgiveness. I think they were wanting two people to forgive each other and get back together again. That's another matter. That's too big of a matter for me to discuss tonight when I'm talking about something else. That's something that needs to be gone into at great length. To forgive them does not mean you give them a chance to hurt you again. Now, some people didn't mean to hurt you, and they probably won't hurt you again once they know how badly you feel. Some people don't care. Some people are glad that you hurt because they get to hurt you once. And now if you don't forgive, they're hurting you again. So much for forgiveness. There is healing in forgiveness. When you forgive somebody else, a burden is lifted from your own heart, and you are now free. Free to do things you couldn't do while that burden was in your heart. That doesn't make okay what the person did. Doesn't mean you have to give them a chance to do it again. I say to women, I'm going to be frank with you. When a husband strays, I tell her, you owe him nothing until you and he test clear. You have no responsibility, even though he's your husband. to get a disease. If he's going to stray, forgive him. Be a good wife. But don't put yourself in a position to get a disease. Forgive him. But don't be stupid. If a woman is beaten up, and I realize there are wives who beat their husbands, okay? If a wife is beaten up and she forgives him, she unlocks the door and he's back in. 2 days later, beats him up again. A week later, beats her up again. Finally, in a couple of years, when she's half dead and all beaten up and all black and blue and a lot of diseases, and she goes to court and she's telling the judge, oh, he did this, 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 this. Believe me, I worked in a courtroom for many years. Judges say, were you crazy? What'd you keep letting them come back for? The first time, maybe you believe him. But after that, you bring it on yourself to open the door and let him back in. Don't let people hurt you. Forgive him. Forgive him doesn't mean like him. Forgive him does not mean trust him. Forgive him doesn't mean what they did was okay. Forgive him means you forgive him so that you and God are on good terms. And there's healing in that. When you are right with God, there's healing from your headaches. There's healing from your throwing up. Because you forgive. There's healing for your mind. There's healing for your body. And there's a healing of your spirit between you and God. Forgiving is forgiving. Nothing more, nothing less. And anybody that will tell you any different just hasn't grown up enough. Huh, they might be 100 years old, but they don't have enough life experience to know any better. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Jesus was tempted. Jesus did not give in to sin. Jesus doesn't tempt you to sin because he died on the cross for your sins. He's not going to tempt you to forgive so that he has sins that he can forgive you. No. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Listen, if you're a new Christian and you're just starting a relationship with God, and you want to be the kind of person that Jesus wants you to be, you're going to have to give up going to the bar with your friends. You're going to have to give up hanging out with some of your friends. Because what they want to talk about, joke about, kid about, you're not about that anymore. You are now about what Christ wants you to think about. Not doing what offends him. God has feelings like you do. Did you know that? What do you think it means when the Bible says you are built, you are made in the image of God? Does that mean I got blue eyes, so God's got blue eyes? I got white hair, so God's got white hairs? I'm made in his image. I can be hurt by other people. I have the ability to hurt God. Yeah, I do. Christ died for me. I've confessed my sins to him. I've lived many years for him. I could do something that would hurt his feelings. I could do something that would embarrass God. It would embarrass the church that has ordained me for over 60 years. I can hurt God's feelings. I can cause him to feel pain. I can cause him to feel great joy. When I forgive somebody that has hurt me, I can make God really happy and saying, that's my girl. Look what they did to her. Hey, my daughter, she forgave him. To my dad, his little girl could do anything. To my dad, his little girl could do no wrong. I was 22 and bought a new car. My dad didn't get a new car till he was in his late 50s. I was an evangelist. We were traveling constantly. Later, we were going into Mexico in places where they didn't know how to fix cars and didn't even have parts for cars. And I felt that, well, we shouldn't have a fancy car. We should have a new car. It just made good sense to me. Better be knowing you're going to make a payment of $100 than that no, you might have to make a repair job of who knows how much. So I always had new cars. And my parents came to see me. We were preaching in another town and had a trailer parked at somebody's house out in the country. And we had a new car. And we met my parents somewhere in town. And they said, let's go to a restaurant. And my dad said, okay, we'll go in our car. I said, no, we can go in mine. My dad said, no, my car's bigger. I said, no, I've got a new car. My mother says, you don't have a new car. Young like you are, traveling all over the country, no money, you don't have a new car. My dad says, yep, my baby's got a new car. My little girl has got a new car. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine, God, yours is the kingdom. Your kingdom come. Where we, who are caught up with him, and our bodies are changed into a glorified body like Jesus had after his resurrection. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. That was Jesus' answer when one of the disciples said, you pray all the time. Because he would leave them and he would go a little bit farther down the road where he could pray by himself, but they would be nearby. And he would pray. He needed to be alone with his Father. And I need to spend some time with my Father in heaven. If I don't, I lose that fellowship. Prayer is not telling God what you want and expecting him to, if you really like me, God, you'd give me this. No, that's what a 10-year-old will say to their parents. If you really love me, you would buy me a new bicycle. No, That's a kid that has learned how to play the game. I'm looking to see what time it is. We have about 25 minutes left in the amount of time that technically, I mean, I can quit early, I can go a little over, but technically that's about where we are. Let me see where we are here. Let me go on a couple more verses and maybe another 5 minutes and then I'll close and then we'll chat. Okay? You feel like chatting? Okay. If you forgive men their trespasses, that means the bad stuff they do. If you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Why would God give you forgiveness if you wouldn't give it to others? Did God forgive you because you're so cute? Because you're so smart? Because you got it going for you? If you forgive men, your heavenly Father will also forgive me. If you forgive not men their trespasses, the things they do to hurt you, neither will your Father forgive you yours. It just seems like the wrong stuff we do isn't all that bad. But the stuff people do to us is terrible. No. Sin is sin. Sin makes God cry. You're his child. You don't do what he asks you to do. How are you going to deal with it as a parent? When your kids don't do what you ask them to. Well, you got to bring them up. You got to discipline them, or else they're going to grow up to be crazy and have no responsibility at all. You've got to discipline them. But what are your feelings going to be? You know, you've heard this before, honey, this hurts you more than it hurts me. Yeah. If you're principal of a school, if you're a father. But if you forgive not men, your Father will not forgive you. Moreover, when you fast, fasting is something we haven't done for a long time in prayer and praise. When I first started it, we used to have every few months a time of fasting and prayer. Fasting means giving up eating and spending that time in prayer. It also means denying yourself something. You're going to get a tummy ache maybe if you don't eat. Your stomach's going to growl. It's not going to kill you. It's giving up food. It's making yourself a little bit uncomfortable. The hypocrites, they want people to know they're fasting so that people will think, ooh, how holy. And they take their hair down. My hair is so long. When it comes down, I look a mess. Hair all over. On top of that, they put on a sad face. I'm fasting. I love God. I'm in pain, but I'm doing it because I am such a good Christian. You do that, you got your reward. You got your reward. You want people to see you with a long face, and they have just looked at your long face. You want people to say, oh, how holy. And they just said, oh, how holy. That's what you wanted? That's what you got. Now, if you do it for godly reasons, then wipe that sad, bewrinkled look off your face. He says, anoint yourself. Anointing yourself is pouring oil over yourself. I can remember when I was young, there were certain periods of my life when the guys would wear a lot of oil in their hair and slick it back down. Yeah, because I have also lived where they just have a little mohawk hair. I've lived long enough to where guys have had all kinds of crazy hairdos. He said, if that's what you want, is people to look at you. People look at you. If you want to look holy, then look holy. But God knows what's in your heart. And He knows if you're just trying to look holy or if you want to be like Him and be holy. He says, I'm telling you, they got their reward. When you fast, anoint your head. When people were sad, when they were grieving, when they lost a loved one, they would sit at the side of the road. They would take their hair down. They would put dirt in their hair. And they would sit there like a bedraggled person so people would know, oh, they must have lost somebody in their family. See, when you fast, put oil on your head, wash your face, put a smile on your face, and hope that if your tummy growls, nobody hears it. Because that's not the point. That's not what it's all about. Lay up for yourselves treasures. If you're interested in having a new car, you're interested now. You know me, and you all know where I shop. $3 last week at the local thrift store, because it's fun to shop there. Because you get a bunch of stuff for very little money. But if you want to wear expensive jewelry, gold, silver, all of that, fine. Your heart is going to be where your stuff is. You're going to be thinking about, I wonder if anybody has gone in my house and found where I keep my good jewelry. I wonder if anybody knows where I've hidden this. Because that stuff means a lot to you and it's on your mind. So if it's on your mind, it's in your heart. If it's on earth, if it's jewelry, if it's gold, if it's silver, if it's silk and satin, velvet clothing, it's going to get dirty. It's going to wear out. Moths are going to eat it up. Thieves are going to come in your house. Can happen. And steal. Wherever your treasure is, that's where your heart is. If that stuff is important to you, that's where your heart is. If other things, and I'm looking for a pen that will write. And I had one the other moment. Let me see if this one writes. Yeah, it does. If you're interested in eternal things, in your soul, in pleasing God, in making God happy, then that's where your heart is. I'm going to close right here because otherwise we're just going on to other things. And I'd rather stop and have a few minutes just to chat. Let me mark here where we are. And today is 1:15:17, and that's where we'll begin next week. Now, before we chat, and I turn it up so that everybody here can chat with us, let me turn off. We've got a 1 hour and 30 minutes and 25 second video. Kind of long. But you don't have to watch the whole thing at one time. So until the next video, God bless you.